Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening. Welcome. Thank you very much indeed for coming this evening. My name is Ian McBride. I'm a Kent-based journalist, so do feel free to boo me. I also live in Kent, but not in this neck of the woods. My role tonight is to try and share this impartially. I have no vested interest whatsoever. As you can see on the top table, we have Dr. Hilary Newport from CPRE and Martin Potts from Highways England. We also have Martin's colleague, Mike Brown. Both Hilary and Martin will do a presentation, and then we will throw the floor open to questions from yourselves. This is very much your meeting. Before we do that, I have to do the boring bits, the housekeeping rules. If you have mobile phones, could you please turn them off? If you can't bear to be parted, could you please put them on silent? As you'll notice, there are cameras around here. This meeting is being webcast live by Gravesend Borough Council. There are also some council photographers about. If you're not happy to be recorded for posterity, please let them know. Fairly obviously, it's no smoking. If anybody needs toilets, they are up to my left and down to my right. Thank you to the volunteers from St John's Ambulance who are here tonight doing a splendid job as they always do. So if anybody is feeling faint, please make contact with them. There is no fire alarm or fire drill scheduled for this evening. Should the fire alarms go off, the assembly point is back through the main door to my left and outside by the sort of the clay equipment area. The plan is for each of the speakers to do a 15-minute presentation, and I would ask, please, you'd show them the courtesy you would expect if you were making a presentation. So I'll ask, firstly, Martin Potts from Highways England.
Okay, thank you very much, Ian, and thank you to residents of Gravesend for inviting me here this evening. I very much look forward to a stimulating and interesting discussion this evening. So my intention is to give you a quick overview of the proposals. I will have met many of you at the information events we've been holding in the borough. So if you've seen the material before, apologies. Those of you who might not have seen the material before, hopefully it's of some use to you. So old-fashioned semaphore now to get the next slide. Okay, so hopefully you can see that from the back. I know there's a lot of information like infographic, but I'll just talk to the key kind of facts and figures. So just putting it in context as why we're here tonight, I guess it's because we feel there's a problem with the Dartford crossing that we need to solve. So just to put that in context, the crossing carries about 50 million vehicle movements a year, typically 150,000 vehicles a day. Sometimes it's got as high as 170,000. Against a design capacity of 135,000 vehicles. So for much of the time, the crossing is congested. The other thing we need to recognize is that within that traffic mix, there's quite a high volume of heavy goods and light commercial vehicles. It being the sole crossing of the Thames, it's clearly the only way that sort of traffic can go. We're also recognised within our traffic modelling work, as the economy grows and develops, we're recognised that that content, that heavy goods and commercial vehicle content, will increase to 34% by 2041, which is our design year. That design year, it's a bit of a terminology thing, but basically government doesn't invest in major infrastructure that's fit on the day of opening, but rather tests that infrastructure is okay for 15 years beyond the opening date. So that's where we come up with this magic date of 2041. So performance of the crossing. Over the last month or so, we've had a number of incidents at the crossing. A couple of weeks back, of course, we had Storm Imogen, where we had to close the bridge for a day. I was at a public information meeting in South Ockenden that day. I live in Kent. It took me 4.5 hours to go 3 miles from South Ockenden to the bridge. So I do recognise from personal experience that in performance terms, when something goes wrong on the sole crossing of the Thames, it does mean gridlock for local communities in both Dartford and Thurrock, and also further afield, clearly here in Gravesend, as that traffic chaos spreads out. So the other day I was going up to Essex, and there's a problem on the A2. I think it was, I know it was coastbound, and that caused a degree of confusion as well. So whenever we get these incidents, and typically they might take 27 minutes, I think on average, to clear the effect of the incident takes between 3 and 5 hours to clear. So why does that happen? Well, it's because traffic basically queues in a queue that grows very quickly round to junction 3 or up to junction 29 and beyond, as traffic is frustrated in making that crossing journey. And then, of course, we need to think about safety and environment. So the actual A282, as it goes through Dartford, is clearly a very congested road. We've got lots of local junctions, lots of merging traffic as the heavy goods vehicles try to move to lane 3 and 4, which perversely is where the larger of the two tunnels is. And that in itself leads to a higher than normal average of incidents that we are talking to. So you all know the problems. I don't really want to dwell on it further, but that just kind of puts it in context. It's a big problem that we need to solve. It is consistently, Dartford Crossing is consistently one of the worst 5 performing bits of our national network. So let's just recognise what it is. It's a serious problem we have to solve. So a bit of reflection on what the objectives of the project are all about. Basically, they're threefold, looking at transport, looking at the economy, and looking at the community and environment. So as far as transport, we've got to relieve congestion on the crossing and approach roads. We want to improve its resilience. We want to improve safety. In terms of economic objective, we want to support sustainable local and regional development. Clearly, any solution we table needs to be affordable to government and the users, and it needs to represent value for money. And in terms of community environment, naturally, we want to minimise the adverse effects on health and on the environment. So in undertaking our study work, we looked at a short list of options, and essentially we looked at 4 options. Route 1, which was an improvement on the A282 itself at Dartford. Then routes 2, 3 and 4 were alternative routes across South Essex with variants in Kent in terms of the eastern, what we're calling the eastern southern link and the western southern link going each side of Shorne Country Park. Okay, so let's just talk about Route 1, because I'm very conscious of the conversations I've had with some of you at the Pies and some of the email exchanges I've had to respond to and some of the ministerial comment about location A, Route 1. So when we looked at this route in detail, we did recognise in our study work that investment on Route 1 would provide some journey time benefits. But in terms of other aspects, it would have limited a wider economic value. It is and could only be a widening scheme. So whatever we do by way of additional crossings of the river, whether it be a tunnel or a bridge, the benefit of that crossing is limited by virtue of what you can do on the approach road to it, particularly through Dartford. We've got a very constrained corridor through Dartford. All we could sensibly do is open up the hard shoulder to live lane running, which would mean another lane of traffic. So you wouldn't get the maximum benefit of another two-lane crossing the river because you can't get that traffic to the crossing. Moreover, if we did improve the approach roads in a dramatic way to get all the extra capacity used, we'd have to be demolishing hundreds of homes in Dartford to facilitate that, and it would be an unaffordable scheme, and it would be hugely damaging to Dartford and the locality. The other thing we need to recognise, I suppose, is that people talk about the M25 being an orbital motorway around London. Well, of course it isn't. At Dartford and Thurrock, it's the A282. It's a different sort of road. It hasn't got motorway characteristics. At best, traffic can only go at 50 miles an hour, and certainly when you go through the tunnels, you're not travelling at 50 miles an hour because of the nature of the tunnels. So it is, in fact, operates as a congested sort of hotspot. The other thing we need to recognise is that a solution at A would put more and more pressure on the A13 and the A2, other connecting roads east-west that feed into the M25. And, again, to address those problems, you'd be widening those roads, and the scope of the project would just grow and grow and grow. So then we need to think about construction. Constructing a solution at Dartford would entail a much longer construction period from those other options that we considered. It's essentially because we'd have to relocate all the buildings and so on we have at Dartford to facilitate construction of another bridge or tunnel. This would add 2 years to the construction program. Construction activity itself would be extremely difficult and challenging because we'd be constructing major infrastructure whilst also operating a road carrying upwards of 150,000 vehicles a day. That would be a considerable challenge to the business. Yes, it is something we do all the time. Over the last 6-7 years or more, we've widened the M25, but that is kind of challenging. It's also quite expensive to do in terms of productive work. It's an inefficient work practice to actually build such a road. And also we need to recognise actually the safety of the work people on the construction site and the travelling public. If it can be avoided, it's best not to widen roads in this sort of manner. But of course, what's really important in all of this is that, you know, opportunities like this are opportunities where you can have your say and provide feedback. And please, I'd encourage you all, if you haven't taken part in the consultation and responded, please do that. So just to clarify the point about if option A is on the table, you may have picked up on ministerial announcements on it. Yes, as far as the government is concerned, of course, it is on the table. In the 2014, the Minister of the day instructed Highways England, to consider further locations A and C and bring to public consultation, kind of late 2015, early 16, our proposals. And that's essentially what we're doing here as Highways England. So in all our consultation material, we're very clear in explaining that Highways England believe the proposed solution is a solution around a crossing east of Gravesend, location C. But as the Minister said in announcements the other day, clearly the government have yet to make their decision, and clearly in that sense, if people are minded to comment on location A, of course you're at liberty to do so. So what are we consulting on as Highways England? Essentially, it's routes 2, 3 and 4 in Essex as viable options, and the eastern and western southern link as viable options. All have commonality in a bored tunnel crossing east of Gravesend. So in combination, clearly there are six possible routes there that we believe as Highways England are viable options that would satisfy the project objective. Okay, so how to respond? I've nearly got to the end. So again, just repeating messages that you're probably well aware of. But please respond to the consultation. You can go on our website and respond sort of electronically in the sort of modern way. Please come to public information events where you can obviously speak to myself or my team and ask specific questions. The next events in this side of the river are next Monday and Tuesday in Maidstone and Rochester, respectively. Alternatively, you can go to deposit locations, your local libraries, and pick up hard copies of the questionnaires and return them in the old-fashioned sort of way.
Martin, okay, thank you. Thank you very much indeed. I'll now invite Dr. Hilary Newport from the Campaign for the Protection of Rural England to speak.
Thank you, Ian, and I'm delighted to be able to be here this evening to be able to explain what CPRE Kent and my colleagues within the Kent branch as well as our national office are bringing to this consultation. I want to make it absolutely clear that our consultation response is going to be that both choices remain entirely unacceptable to us in terms of impacts to communities, in terms of impacts on the environment, and against the backdrop of levels of air pollution that are already intolerable. It's been in the news a great deal recently. Royal College of Physicians published their report only last week saying that 40,000 preventable deaths occur because of additional air pollution. We heard only yesterday that Client Earth are thinking of challenging the government in court because of their failure to act quickly enough to bring down these levels of air pollution. I think it's becoming increasingly clear that a business as usual approach as far as of traffic growth is concerned is no longer an option. Of course, we completely recognise that congestion and pollution in Dartford is a serious problem that needs solving now. But what I want to do is step back and explore whether the only solution to solving the current problems is a damaging and expensive new road crossing. About a quarter of the traffic that's using the Dartford crossing at the moment, as Martin has said, is freight. And I want to focus on this in particular in order to demonstrate how we've arrived at the position we're at and maybe to share with you some of our thought processes and maybe for you to test our thought processes yourselves as to whether we're coming to the right conclusions. Now, for all sorts of reasons, mostly historical, the UK is heavily dependent on road-based freight. And obviously, it is the case that the free and efficient flow of goods and services is an essential prerequisite to a buoyant economy. But if the free flow of freight through our networks is a good thing, is it absolutely necessarily the case that the free flow of more freight through our networks is necessarily a better thing? For example, a huge proportion of the UK's freight, and this is the whole country, I'm not talking about Kent here, a huge proportion of our freight enters and exits through the channel crossings, that's the tunnel and the existing ports at Dover. HGV traffic just through the port of Dover is increasing at about 8% per year, and the port's got ambitious plans for expansion on the cards over and above that. But it seems to me that unconstrained, continued growth like this is happening in blissful, almost willful ignorance of the consequences for the wider highways network, for the environment and for the health and the well-being of the communities along those highways networks further afield. Now, coming back to Dartford, a new Thames crossing might well ease some of the current congestion in the short term, but we know that new roads fill up, and we know that they fill up quickly. We know this because we've learnt some very clear lessons in the past, and I'll take a couple of moments, if I may, to share with you the learnings of the Newbury bypass. Now, this was one of the first major environmental campaigns that I became aware of. I lived in the area at the time, so it was pretty obvious. But the media really picked up in the mid-90s on the protests that were going on as Swampy and his colleagues were regularly filmed up trees and down holes trying to prevent the building of the Newbury bypass. Now, the people who were promoting the bypass said that it was absolutely essential to improve road safety in the area. They said it was essential to put to an end the intolerable congestion in what was then still the rather lovely market town of Newbury. Meanwhile, the objectors were fighting to stop the destruction of 120 acres of woodland and sensitive habitats. Despite that, it got the go-ahead in 1995 and opened to traffic in 1998. But it's the studies that took place after the bypass was completed that, for me, make really grim reading. Traffic on the bypass grew at double the rate of traffic on comparable roads in the rest of the area. And it's clear evidence that this was what we call induced traffic. It's not traffic that was displaced from other roads. It was additional road journeys. Worse still, within only 7 years, the traffic in Newbury Town Centre was back to its pre-bypass levels. And the road traffic accident rate, both in Newbury Town Centre and on the new roads, was up rather than down from its pre-bypass levels. Also, to add insult to injury, the colony of very rare snails that had had to be relocated from the route of the bypass at huge expense was found to be locally extinct within 10 years of its relocation. So within less than 10 years and at the expense of £100 million, Newbury was worse off than it was before the bypass was built. So if we're going to learn these lessons, if we're going to try to tackle congestion or manage transport networks, it's really important to look at the lessons we've learnt to understand whether new road building is genuinely going to help or hinder those aims. If you're responsible for spending public money, you probably need to know that it's actually going to be delivering public benefits. And we all need to be absolutely certain that a new road scheme is genuinely going to improve conditions before we can even begin to weigh up the benefits against the environmental damage that it's going to cause. Now, the issue of induced traffic growth, I think, is a really significant one here. The introductory paragraphs, I've marked them here, of your consultation document, highlights the importance of stimulating economic growth and access to housing and job opportunities. But I would query whether there is a difference between unlocking existing potential, on the one hand, or on the other hand, creating a vacuum that's going to accelerate the pull of unsustainable growth in jobs, housing, roads, into an area that is already incredibly overstressed. Don't let's forget that the Newbury bypass failed to meet any of its objectives. So, rather than focusing on ever more roads, which will be as full as ever before long, within CPRE Kent, we're calling for a genuinely sustainable integrated transport strategy. That's a strategy that doesn't foster and encourage the growth of road-based freight through Kent or anywhere else. The solutions, well, we should certainly focus on getting more freight off our roads and onto rail. There is capacity, there's a great deal of capacity for freight within the tunnel. That I'm not talking about lorries on trains, I'm talking about freight trains through the tunnel. That's not currently used because of economic decisions and treaties that were taken back in 1980-something, long before the tunnel was built. Well, that's not rocket science. Let's address that first. Let's unlock that potential. I say this in particular because the consultation document also makes it quite clear on page 10, here we go. On page 10, here we go. This study has also ruled out rail as a solution to the problems at Dartford. Well, I think that's a betrayal of all of the basic principles of sustainability, and I think the people in Kent and Essex deserve better than that. Let's look at better ways to be doing the stuff that we need to do. If we are at risk of losing sight of the lessons that we've learnt from the Newbury bypass and others, I could point to several other examples where similar learnings have been found. I also sometimes wonder if we're at risk of losing sight of last summer's experience when for 30 days the county was paralysed through the application of Operation Stack. So, you know, even ignoring the environmental impacts of that, in economic terms, we are putting an awful lot of the nation's economic eggs into what is an increasingly fragile basket, which is the Channel Corridor, which transfers so much of the freight that's needed to move between mainland Britain and the rest of UK. We need something that's going to offer our nation better resilience as well as a better quality of life for people all over Kent and all over Essex. Now, you know, I do get it. The short channel crossing is cheap and it's quick for freight operators, so of course they will prefer to use those routes. But I think that that's because the real costs and the implications of those short channel hops are borne by the communities and the environment further afield. I think it's an artificially cheap option. 60% of all of the freight that moves in and out of the UK travels via the channel crossings, and most of this is travelling to or from places which are far distant from Kent. I just think that if we could look at sensible ways of reducing this particular burden on this particular bottleneck, and Kent can't help being the pointy bit that separates the rest of the UK from mainland Britain. We can't do much about that. But a really good place to start would be trying to find alternative ways. So besides a shift to rail, let's also look at ways that we could maybe incentivise the smarter use of ports of entry and exit that don't rely on onward road travel across the Thames, across the bottleneck that is Dartford. We've got London Gateway coming online, the other side of the river, significant rail connection opportunities there. We've got the ports at Harwich, we've got Liverpool crying out for additional growth. Let's look at moving goods and services much closer to their points of origin or destination. Let's look at rebalancing, perhaps, the relative costs of road miles against some of the more sustainable transport options. This gives us the benefit of improving the resilience of our transport networks, as well as helping to control pollution. So don't let's just support growth for the sake of growth without looking at sensible and sustainable options. I would contend that what we need is a solution that's going to last us well into the 21st century, not a quick fix for the Dartford congestion that's happening at the moment. I think that business as usual growth is going to not do us any favours in the long term. And I would really close by saying that there are so many passionate and intelligent and very, very concerned folk out there. Do not lose this opportunity to have your say. If any of you here in the audience are any of the authors of the pile of letters that I've received on my desk, I apologise that you haven't had an acknowledgement yet. I know where you're coming from, and we're doing all we can to help you. But please make sure that the Highways Agency and all of your elected representatives get to know what it is you think about these options. Thank you.
Dr. Hilary Newport, thank you very much indeed. As I said at the beginning, this is very much your meeting. I know there are members of County Council here, Borough Council, and Parish representatives as well. Thank you very much for your attendance. What I would like to do is invite ordinary members of the public, no disrespect, to have your say first, if I may. We have had some questions submitted in advance. People are also submitting questions via Twitter. As I said at the beginning, this is being webcast. So those of you who would like to speak, could I ask you to raise your hands in the normal way? If you're comfortable, could you come to the microphone at the front, please? If not, there are microphones at the side. And could I ask, again, because it is being webcast, could you say your name and also where you're from or if you're representing a group? Start with the gentleman right at the back, as your hand was up first, sir. Could I also ask just to keep comments and questions relatively brief? I don't want to be censorious, but we want to make sure as many people as possible have their say.
That's okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you to the two speakers, first of all. My name is Mike Higgins. I'm from Thong Lane. I'd like to agree, first of all, with Dr. Newport said about transferring transport, heavy goods, etc., to the rail systems. I don't believe that's even been considered, sir, by your options. Not realistically. I'd like to question how much damage is going to be done to Gravesend and to Strood, because although this may be a link onto it, the amount of traffic flowing through these towns when the road gets blocked up, and it will, is going to be enormous. It's already bad enough. It's going to be huge if your new tunnels get blocked up. Secondly, I'd like to know how much money does the Dartford Crossing currently make for its owners? And is this new tunnel going to be tolled as well? So we're looking at a long-term investment with a huge return for somebody. Next, I'd like to know, you made the comment about it stopping tailbacks at the Dartford Tunnel. It's not going to do that. It's just going to create yet further tailbacks further down the motorway when it gets blocked up, and it's going to create even longer tailbacks when it gets to the Dartford Tunnel. So I think you're talking complete gibberish, to be quite honest. You talk about knocking a scheme that might knock down hundreds of houses in Dartford. What's the difference between the houses in Dartford and the houses that you're proposing to knock down here? I think that's absolutely disgraceful. It's a very bad comment to make, okay? And I think you should withdraw it, and you should be honest, okay? Because it's our houses you're dealing with, not yours, okay? Lastly, if I may, Mr. Chairman, my final point, okay? There's one other thing that's not been mentioned. A few years ago, 3 or 4 years ago, we lived in Cliff for a long, long time. At Cliff, we had Mr. Boris Johnson's wonderful airport. Building a crossing at Gravesend, east of Gravesend, makes it easier for him to argue to put the airport back. Because he can get traffic from his airport into London quicker. We don't want that. We don't want your crossing. And we'd rather, in the words of whoever he was, I think as far as I'm concerned, sir, you've sat there far too long. In the name of God, go. Because you seem uninterested and your attitude is smug. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mike. Can I just ask, ladies and gentlemen, I appreciate feelings are running very high tonight, but please can you not make it personal? Thank you. No, it's personal to you, but I mean personal to the individual sitting up here. I hear what you say, Mike. Martin.
Okay, thank you very much. Clearly, there's a number of questions there. I hope I've captured them all. So I think one of the first questions I think you raised was about charging and toll levels. So the current government policy is that any new crossings such as what's been proposed would carry a charge. So that's the first remark. In terms of where that money goes, it goes into Treasury. So let's squash any of those ideas that it goes anywhere else. In terms of housing, of course I empathise with those people who are personally affected. We all live somewhere. I think the point I was trying to make is, we can't lose sight of the problem we've got to solve, and we can't walk away from, is that we've currently got road infrastructure that doesn't work crossing the river, and the local conurbations, whether it be Dartford, Gravesend, or Thurrock. Clearly, when things go wrong on that road, as sadly they do from time to time, there are accidents. We can't do anything about that. These things happen. The tailbacks are, back up pretty quickly, and the rat running that goes on around that occurs. So our proposals essentially are to address that problem. The worst thing you can do for air pollution, recognizing that the traffic on our roads is a contributor of air pollution, is to actually have standing traffic. These proposals are around making viable options that will free up that network and make it work. That's really what ultimately we're proposing.
The gentleman down here, just in the second row with his hand up, get a microphone. Thank you.
After 30 years...
Sorry, could you just say your name, please?
Oh, it's
from?
Raymond Stiles from Cliffwoods.
Thank you.
I've spent 30 years as a service engineer going around the M25 and the road network. And it really infuriates me to the fact that I spent probably the best part of half a year in delays on the M25 going to that Dartford Tunnel, where I've had to go the option of the M26 down to Cuxton Road to get home because I can't get the access route to come off at the A2 junction, all because of the tunnel delays. It's magic now it's improved with the abolition of the toll booths, but I think we got stitched up to the fact that that tunnel was meant to be free after a given time and it had paid for itself. So we all owed the best solution to the problem. We're in credit. Certainly that tunnel owes me literally a half a year of my life queuing up for hours on end trying to get to the A2 junction to come off and get home, rather than going down M26 to Cuxton Road. So you're indebted to most people here, not to make a profit out of it. You owe it to us.
Thank you.
That's my case.
Okay, I'll take it. Okay, so thank you for that. This is entirely a matter for government charging and on the road network. It's not a matter for Highways England. I say the current government policy is that such crossings are charged. Clearly, I can't talk about what previous governments might have said. Governments come and go. The situation at the moment is that such crossings would be charged.
Gentleman there in the middle. If you're happy to, please. And again, if I could just ask you to say your name and where you're from or whether you're representing a group, please.
Thank you. I'm Tamanjit Desi. I'm speaking in a personal capacity, but also formally as chairman of Gravesend Labour Party. Gravesend Labour Party has consistently opposed option C, and that is for a variety of reasons. The huge detrimental impact on the quality of life of Gravesend residents, whether it's on account of the environmental damage that it will do to an area of outstanding natural beauty, the gridlock that it would cause within not just Gravesend and east of Gravesend, but also across Northfleet, as it will no doubt be used for a rat run in due course. But we are not opposed to a third crossing per se. Indicated that if there was a crossing, you know, further east, to link up the Wainscot bypass or even further afield, that those are options which should be considered. Now, originally, when the idea was mooted, it was sold to us that there would be consideration for trying to link the M11 to the M20, you know, in view of the wider national strategic for our road networks. Now, why is that not being considered anymore? Because the current option C is merely linking the M25 to the A2. There was talk that what we should be doing is that we want to get rid of a problem of a bottleneck. Now, isn't what we're doing with option C merely creating another bottleneck? Because you'll be having a tunnel at a huge expense, in excess of £5 billion, to create a two-lane road, which, you know, there will be gridlock on both sides. So can we address that? I'll leave it with those two questions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So there's a couple of important points there that clearly we need to cover. So the first one really was a challenge around why haven't we looked further east? Well, of course, we have looked further east. This was done back in 2009 in the studies that the department led that looked at five options, A, B, C, D, and E. We then had a previous consultation on Lower Thames Crossing in 2013, where the government were asking views about A, B, and C, which ultimately led to this consultation, where clearly we're bringing to you all Highways England's views on options A and C. Now, the reason routes further downstream were discounted was primarily because they didn't do anything to address the problem that is congestion and serious implications of that at Dartford. Studies for a route that goes from essentially the end of the Wainscot bypass and the Argrain up to Canvey Island showed that only 3% of traffic is drawn away from Dartford. So you'd still be faced with a serious challenge around the reliability and performance of the Dartford crossing. Also, we need to recognise that, of course, as you go further downstream, the river is getting wider, so the actual cost of that infrastructure is going up. And also, of course, we need to have significant investment to build the road capacity to get down onto Canvey Island to service such a crossing. So, you know, at the end of the day, Highways England is challenged to find affordable solutions for government. Government wants to sort the problem that is the congestion at Dartford. It is keen to sort it, is keen to work with communities to find affordable solutions that work for everybody. You know, I do recognise, of course, that, you know, it's hugely challenging for us all to try and find those solutions. But we have a situation at the moment that kind of doesn't work. The road network is in crisis. Every single day or every other day, something happens that frustrates movement across the crossing at Dartford. And you all know the effect of that kind of more than I do, in as much as, you know, you have to live with the congestion and the way or the networks that are inappropriate for taking diversionary traffic clog up. So, you know, this is about building sensible diversion routes for traffic. At the moment, everything funnels from Kent or Essex on one solitary crossing. I said earlier in my earlier remarks that, you know, that bit of the network performs very poorly. It's one of our worst performing bits of the network. And the consequences on health shouldn't be forgotten. The worst thing you can do in terms of traffic-induced pollution is to have traffic standing regularly in queues. That's what happens at Dartford very frequently.
Can I just, one other element of that gentleman's question, Martin, was all you're going to do is create gridlock around Gravesham. I'm sure you've done your modelling. What's the answer to that?
Okay, thank you. So, of course, in our traffic modelling work, we not only do we look at what the implications of our road are in terms of movement on that road, but also what it means to associated roads. So I already spoke earlier to the fact that a new crossing at sea would relieve congestion on the A2 and the A13. Now, what happens at the moment when those roads get congested? Clearly, there's some displaced traffic from them into the local communities. So, you know, this is about trying to get the primary road network working. And when it's working, you won't get displaced traffic onto local road networks. But at the moment, the primary network isn't working effectively. And what that means is that traffic is displaced onto local networks that aren't built or designed or appropriate for such traffic.
Lady here in the purpley dress, that's probably the wrong colour, so I do apologise. Again, if you would mind saying your name, please, and if you're representing a group, thank you.
Sarah Paul from Western Hanging Castle. Last year, Highways England cost me £30,000. Now, that was due to the M20 operation stack. I've got Western Hanger Castle, and I've got a house in Halling. On the A228, we have already got St Peter's being moved over to Halling through the new bridge. We've also got St Andrews. Now, we are constantly stuck on the A228 doing different things. My husband travels up and down the A2 onto the M25 for his work. You have forgotten about the Garden City at Ebbsfleet. You have forgotten about Paramount. One thing that Tam mentioned, Gravesend will be gridlocked. Do you not think that Gravesend will be gridlocked because of Paramount and also Ebbsfleet City? Since the tolls have gone, or the booths have gone, the congestion has got worse. You promised when you got rid of those booths, the congestion would be better. Since those booths have gone, either the bridge has been shut or the tunnels have been shut. Now, if we stop the freight on the M20 and get it back onto the ports, and back onto the railway, we will have a better road network. The £250 million that Damien Collins has got for the back of my land is ridiculous. It will not save Operation Stack. That will still happen until we get freight off the roads.
I think I'll invite Dr. Newport first to respond to that.
What can I say except, yes, I agree with all of the above. We've used many of the same arguments against the construction of a honking great lorry park at the foot of the Kent Downs AONB as we have against the unconstrained expansion of freight through Kent. Totally support everything you've said. We need to be rethinking the way we're moving freight fundamentally, not just incrementally, crawling towards the lowest common denominator. Thank you.
Martin?
Okay, so just speaking to that freight point first and rail, and then I'll just pick up the other points. So in terms of rail capacity and its suitability for freight, in earlier study work in 2009, we concluded there's enough freight capacity on the existing rail networks that's unlikely to be filled by 2031. So what we've got at the moment clearly is some capacity there, but commercial decisions are commercial decisions, and freight is moved as it currently is. The other thing I read to kind of just explain, I guess, and it, you know, it might be uncomfortable sort of hearing this, but you know, you're talking to Highways England. We have been tasked by government to look at a road-based solution to what is the Dartford problem. This is about our duty as the highway operator to make the highway network work. Yes, we can take away comments you've made on wider policy matters, but they're not for Highways England. As far as the lady's comment about the A2 and the A228, yes, as part of our traffic modelling work, clearly we do look at the knock-on effect on associated roads. Our traffic model does include projections for Ebbsfleet Garden City. It does include projections for other development in local borough council plans and so on and so forth. You know, my team have worked with your local authorities to understand what your local plans are, and the traffic that would be generated from those local plans, those local sustainable plans, has been factored into our design assumptions.
Gentleman at the top, on the top tier with his hand up there, please.
Good evening, my name's Andy Moore and I'm from Thong Lane. I've got two things. Firstly, the tunnel itself, Martin said that you had looked at the Wainscot bypass, but it didn't provide enough benefit. If you took the tunnel, instead of it being north-south, and made it east-west, you're not taking it further around the river, but you can then link it to the bypass. Secondly, the cost for the tunnel, does that include all the ancillary costs for the junctions? I don't believe that $4.5 billion does. Thank you.
Okay, so there's a couple of questions there. So in terms of our cost projections, we're showing a range of costs between 4.3 and 5.9 billion for what our proposed solution. Yes, those figures do include for everything we expect of the scheme. There are questions that we want to ask local communities around local connections and junctions. They're not essential to the scheme, but clearly there's a community interest should the scheme go forward as to whether you'd want access to that new road. So that's why we've got specific questions around the junctions. As far as the routes are concerned, yes, you know, we did look at alternative routes in terms of the scoping work that I asked my consultants to look at when looking at option C. We did look at variants around the route that we're ultimately tabling in consultation material. What we found was there was only one viable place to actually build a tunnel under the river, and that's at the location that's shown in the detailed plans. Why am I saying that? It's largely because of the sensitive nature of the Ramsar site that follows the course of the river, the marsh sites, and so on and so forth. So we need to be crossing that at the shortest location, but also in a practical position where we can connect back to the A2 or the M2.
Lady just down here in the third row.
Hello, I'm Julie and I live in Chalk. There's two questions really. one I really can't get my head around is how you can justify spending $5 billion to reduce the waiting time in rush hour traffic by 5 minutes in Dartford. It actually says that in that brochure. And I cannot understand how 5 minutes after somebody waiting, there was a gentleman earlier that said he had to wait hours upon hours most of his life going through all these places, how you can justify that, $5 billion for 5 minutes off a waiting time at Dartford and destroying the whole of Gravesham area, people's houses, pollution, devastation, upset for 5 minutes. Don't get it. The other thing is the pollution. When I spoke to somebody at Highways England, I said I'd be effectively living next to two large exhaust pipes, meaning the tunnel. And she said, her words were, it won't be a great deal of pollution. The man there said to me, I can't remember their names, the man said, pollution goes up and then it disperses. And this was a technical person. And the other person said to me there, it will be 0.06 amount of pollution that would be increased if you were 200 metres away from the tunnel. So I said, effectively, if I come up my house and don't turn to the right, I'll be okay then. Because these are two issues. Pollution, I'm not a scientist, I don't understand. But I know farewell, if someone stood in front of me and lit a cigarette, it would be more than 0.06. Thank you for your time.
Okay, so Martin, five billion for 5 minutes. And then pollution goes up.
Okay, thank you. So, 5 minutes. Yes, okay. So, thank you. So, our traffic modelling work is really talks to situations where the network is working. One of the real problems we've got at Dartford, we've all experienced good journeys at Dartford. Let's not forget that. But we've also experienced bad journeys at Dartford. And the bad journeys at Dartford Crossing, what are those? What drives those bad journeys? Well, that's about the performance reliability. That's around those times of the day when too many people are trying to use the Dartford Crossing. That's fundamentally what we've got. We've had 15 years of that crossing really acting at capacity. And then what that means is, as each year goes by, with the background growth in traffic we've seen over that 15-year period, there's more and more journeys that are frustrated. Now, the consequence of that frustrated journey is we have standing traffic, and the consequence on sort of health in terms of that's the worst thing you can do in terms of pollution. So, clearly, what we're looking to do is provide additional capacity that will free up Dartford such that it becomes a reliable journey. It'll always be a popular route because it is in the place where people want to make much of their journeys. So that traffic coming around the M25 and wanting to continually round the M25 would naturally use that crossing. But this is our proposal about making that journey reliable. To make that journey reliable, we have to have additional capacity. Now, what does that mean in terms of pollution? We all live somewhere. We experience background levels of pollutants in the atmosphere. It's not true to say all the pollution comes from traffic, but clearly some of it does. Now, in terms of the road itself, the road is clearly, and the traffic on it rather, is a contributor to the pollution that's in the atmosphere. It disperses relatively quickly into the background. So the point my colleagues were probably trying to share with you, Julie, at the event, was that within that sort of 100 meter, 200 meter boundary of the road, you're actually back to background levels in terms of pollution. So in terms of placing the road, we're trying to place it in the most, in the best possible way, recognizing there's lots of conflicting constraints in trying to find a route for such a road.
We do have an expert, I'm told, on pollution in the form of Richard Knox Johnson from CPRE, who I know wants to ask a question. Can I just invite him to make a comment, though, on that first?
PRE. I think the difficulty with pollution levels is there is obviously set out ways in which this should be dealt with. And I have to say, I think the Highways Agency needs to take into account the fact that it can't necessarily hide behind the government if it is completing an illegal act. And I suspect that this whole consultation process is illegal. You say in your document you're anticipating an increase in traffic, which is your reason for wanting to put the new roads in. And we know that's especially amongst diesel HGVs. And this causes deterioration in air quality. Deterioration in air quality. And that's in the area. I know perhaps in one place or another it might be better for a while, but it'll still get worse. This contravenes the European Directive 2008/50/EC, and also a recent judgment in the Supreme Court in London. Particularly, it infringes it in that you do not set out appropriate measures for compliance with the directive, nor do you put forward all air pollution abatement measures, including measures to limit transport emissions, which you should do under law and which the Supreme Court has made clear that you should have put in there. Apart from completely ignoring the judgment of the Supreme Court, which the government and you as their agent have done, which is surely contempt of the Supreme Court, you have no option but to withdraw this consultation process in order to comply with that directive and show us how you are going to improve air quality instead of make it deteriorate, which is what you're doing at the present moment. If not, I would suggest strongly that any decisions you make as a result of this consultation will be challenged by judicial review and are likely to win, in which case further delay and cost will be involved. Thank you.
Martin, I appreciate you're not a legal expert, but...
Okay, thank you, Richard. Very much value that question. Clearly there's a bit of challenge there. What I can't do here is talk on behalf of government. You know, you must recognise I'm here in representing Highways England in its duty to government in terms of proposing this scheme. One thing I can say, though, is government, clearly in the department, you know, we are looking at the transport fleet. You know, there is a recognition that over time, the transport fleet will get more environmentally better in terms of vehicle emissions. You know, we can't get away from the fact that the current way the highway network is operated carries significant volumes of traffic at Dartford, 50 million movements a day. Upwards of 150 to 160,000 vehicle movements a day. That is causing real problems at the moment on the A282 corridor and the A13 corridor, exacerbated by standing traffic. That is fundamentally the problem we need to address. Now, the best thing a highway operator can do to contribute to the environmental reduction is to make sure that the traffic on the network is kept moving. In that way, it produces less pollution. Clearly, that's not happening at the moment in Dartford. These proposals are primarily about freeing up that traffic so it does move. And what are we proposing to do to make that happen? Well, yes, it is providing additional capacity.
The lady in orange just down here, then the Reverend with his hand up, and then the gentleman behind him.
Hello, my name's Anne Schuster. I'm a Chalk resident, and I am not a mathematician, but there's a fundamental point I'm really grappling with here. Tonight, you've stated that the increase in traffic flows across the bridge and the tunnels have exceeded 25% over its design limit. You've also stated in your consultation document that the new crossing will reduce the traffic flows by 14%. And I'm not a mathematician, but how, by reducing 14% from a 25% overload, is going to cure the problem? That's the first thing. I'd also like you to confirm categorically that you have included the paramount figures in your traffic flows, because we're talking about 12,000 to 14,000 cars per day, 365 days a year. So I'd like that confirmed categorically, and if not, obviously that's going to make an additional difference. And coming to the pollution aspect, the new road from where it comes out of the tunnel to the top at Shorne is approximately equivalent to the length of Bluebell Hill, and only slightly less than the gradient of Bluebell Hill at 4%, which is quite steep. That's about 1 in 25. I fail to see how that can mitigate pollution. I found some research that shows that when you have vehicles up a slope like that, it increases the emissions, the NOx emissions, which are the dangerous things that cause problems with respiratory and heart disease and so on, by a factor of 1.6. So how on earth is that route practical? I really don't see it. Perhaps you could explain.
Okay, a few things there. So the first question, I think, was about Paramount Park. Well, of course, Paramount Park is a private venture. They haven't as yet submitted their development consent order. I believe their current thinking is that that will be... Chairman? You carry on. Thank you. So, yes, Paramount Park, as I say, it's a private venture. They haven't submitted their development consent order application as yet, so we don't know the full implications of their proposals.
Hang on, can we have one debate, please? If we're going to have a load of people shouting, it's not going to be a coherent conversation. Martin?
In absolute terms, yes, we haven't included the data. In sensitivity terms, we've considered it. You know, I'm sorry, madam, you know, the absolute fact is we can't include absolute numbers when the applicant for the proposal hasn't shared that with us. We are just as unsighted on the detail of that application as the audience today. That developer hasn't declared its hand and shown that detail to us. In general terms, they talk about peaks of traffic demand on that facility being during the interpeak on our highway network. So what do I mean by that? You know, on that peak morning, that commuting sort of journey on the A2, that won't be the time when people are going to the park. That's what they are saying in their consultation material. We don't know any more than that. Clearly, we are very keen to work with that developer to understand their plans, but as yet, they haven't declared that detail to us. So we are a bit unsighted on it. But we do recognise clearly with the plans that are in the public domain, all those development plans that local authorities have, both for housing and their general job creation and so on and so forth, we are aware of those plans, and those are factored into our traffic modelling work. As clearly other material is made available during the DCO process for Paramount Park, we will naturally include that in our traffic modelling work. So that was the Paramount question. I'm sorry, I've forgotten the pollution gradients. Yes, thank you. So yes, we do recognise clearly the topography of the landscape with the Kent Downs and the AONB and so on, and the river. You know, a road from the river going up over the downs would have to be a gradient of 4%, which is the sort of governed by our standards, basically.
Gentleman here. My apologies, yes.
Okay, so So, as I said, at times, clearly, Dartford itself as a crossing, you know, it is busy. It will still be busy, whatever we do. This is about measures to try and reduce the flows at Dartford. The best way we can do that is with this new proposal, which does bring 14%. Now, what does that 14% mean in reality? It means actually those journeys at Dartford are more reliable than they currently are. In terms of, you know, road networks, what pushes a road into unreliability is that pressure point when it's operating in a congested state and you get what's called flow breakdown and queuing and so on and so forth. So our analysis is indicating that actually the 14% reduction will actually mean that the crossing will operate in a as it intended, albeit it will be very busy.
I'm sorry, we are trying to be fair to people. I appreciate everybody wants to ask a question, but with respect, you have had one. So I'd like the gentleman here, please.
My name is Nigel Bourne. I am the vicar of Chalk, but I'm speaking here in a personal capacity. I've been here for 18 years. I'm 56 now, so it's quite possible that I'll be retired and moved away by the time things are sort of up and running. But I don't want to think of the people who are left here, the people that I've been ministering to over 18 years, being left with a terrible situation. So I still feel a sense of pastoral concern for them, even though I myself might not be experiencing it. I think that Highways England has been, the kindest thing I can say is extremely economical with the actualité in the producing this. You call it the consultation, but really it's a brochure trying to sell option C. I appreciate that you have you're recommending a particular version of option C, and therefore it's perfectly reasonable for you to state reasons. But the document is full of spin and is very partial in its production of the information. I can give you examples of that if you wish. But, a very simple one is that you diss the whole idea of the traffic solution with option A. But in fact, the solution at option A produces the single best reduction of congestion. And in the that is true. In the 2013 consultation, first of all, approximately 90% of those people who responded thought that congestion was the issue that needed to be solved, and that congestion, if the crossing is at Dartford, is reduced to around 75% rather than about 93%, which is the case if it's built at option C. But you don't really make a thing of that in this, because you're trying to sell option C. You deliberately miss out a very key factor in what you're producing here in this brochure. So given the fact that you have been very economical with the truth, and secondly, given that there hasn't been any discernible weight in any of this information relating to the last consultation in 2013, that more people at that stage were in favour of the crossing being at Dartford, and in fact, actually, I do personally feel a lot of sympathy with what Dr. Newport has said, but I mean, if it is a choice between the two, even in these terms, you've ignored the fact that most people last time said that they wanted the crossing at Dartford. If it's a sheer choice between in 2013 between the people who wanted it exactly as you've suggested it at sea without the variant, only 6% wanted it here. And 20% of the people wanted it at Dartford. Even if you include the variant, it brings it up to a figure about 17%, still lower than Dartford. But again, you don't really pick up on that at all. Now, if you're being even-handed, if you're giving the people the information that they really needed to make a balanced, informed decision, you would have included things like that. You haven't. You've just tried to sell option C. Another example is...
Can I ask you to...
Yeah, I will. Yeah,
please.
Yeah. I'll just give you this because I think it's important. It's, people are not being given the full picture. In here on page 18, there's a fantastic picture of what the southern portal might look like. You know, it's so lovely, I might want to have a caravan there and enjoy it, you know, but... Not only is it so beautifully panned in, if that's the focused in, so you miss out all the connecting linking roads and the church right on the corner, but you've also missed out things like the extraction fans, the pump house, the electricity substation, which the Acon report clearly said would need to be included in those things. So it's a pictorial lie. This brochure is trying to sell something. You're not giving people the information that they really need. So given that, given the fact you've been economical with actuality, given the fact that you haven't listened to what people said last time, what confidence can we possibly have that you'll listen to us this time?
Good evening. My name is Mike Brown. I'm the project director for Highways England. I think I'm disappointed to feel that you do feel it's a selling document because we tried very hard to make this objective. Well, if you let me explain, let me put this into context for you. Highways England was asked to by the Department for Transport to assess, identify feasible options at locations A and C, and I think it's done that with a lot of thoroughness. In the last 18 months, which has included traffic modelling, it's included consultations with the local authorities, statutory undertakers, and this part is the public consultation. It is a very genuine attempt to understand what the concerns of the people that are going to be affected by any future proposals to relieve congestion at Dartford are trying to do. And with reference to the number of people in the previous work, that's obviously all available for anyone to read. What we've tried to do through this consultation is to reach to a greater number of people. I think in response to the previous consultation, the response was actually quite small compared to this time. We're part of the way through the consultation period, and the response has been really very high, higher than we predicted, and our predictions were based on other consultations, for example, TfL's Silvertown consultation. So what we're trying to do here is to really understand. So we're not trying to sell. In fact, when I've been at public information events, I've said that quite clearly, and I know the team have to other people. We're presenting what we were asked to do. Department for Transport asked Highways England to look at options at A and at C, and to indicate its proposed option. Now, Highways England has a point of view of its proposed option, and we set that rationale out in the consultation document. We've tried to do that in a way that's accessible and understandable and comprehensive. And it's disappointing if it feels like a selling document. It's not intended to be. It's intended...
Ladies and gentlemen, I just point out this... One second, please. This event is being broadcast on the web. Unfortunately, if you're not near a microphone, people watching and following this can't hear what you're saying. I appreciate you want to make points, but please, can we take them in the order we were doing them? I fully hear what you say, that you're saying that hasn't been addressed.
There is a tension, I think, when we go to consultation, is between coming later with all the detail or coming early to get early points of view. Yeah, we've come as early as we could with these proposals. We haven't got all the detail worked out. We haven't got all the design of the ventilation and all those things. I mean, if we'd done that and gone down to a high level of detail, we might have been another 12 months from now.
Before I go to the gentleman there, who's been very patiently waiting, the gentleman here did say... option A produces the single biggest reduction in congestion rather than option C. Can I invite one of you to answer that?
Okay, thank you. So, I'll draw you back to our transport objectives. So, you know, yes, one of those primary objectives is about congestion. the state is about building a road network that is big enough to cater for the traffic that wants to move on that network. It's not about building excess capacity, because that's kind of unaffordable and wouldn't be appropriate. Now, the real problem we have with investment at A, and we do recognise we could build extra capacity at A, that investment puts all our eggs in one basket. So what you actually have is an unreliable network when something goes wrong. And that's fundamentally the problem that is Dartford. You know, we can't get away from that. Successive governments have grown and grown the crossing capacity. We're at the point now where any additional river crossing capacity, which we could build, wouldn't be fully utilised because the traffic can't get to it.
Okay. I'm sorry, can I repeat the point that people can't hear what you're saying, and we want to allow as many people as possible to have their say tonight. Gentleman there who's very patiently waited.
So they are not mutually exclusive. What Highways England is charged with is trying to find that on balance what is the best proposal.
I'm conscious there's an awful lot of people who want to ask questions tonight, so can I invite this gentleman there and then gentleman diagonally behind him.
Thank you. My name's Jonathan Clay. I'm a local resident from Gravesend, and I'm here only representing my own views. I wanted first of all to thank you, Mr. Potts, for your sending me the documents that I requested 3 weeks ago, so that they arrived by this afternoon's post at 3 o'clock, and to apologise to you that I've not had an opportunity to read them in any detail. But to ask you, where are the other 5 volumes that I also requested at that time? I attended the meeting in the consultation meeting in Shoreham over 3 weeks ago. I rang, as I was asked to do, by the person that was dealing with consultation there, the number that is in the consultation brochure, and spoke to the hapless young man at the other end, who said that he knew absolutely nothing about it, but he would try to find out and would call me back. He didn't call me back. I eventually got an email which sent me some of the documentation on this, and I asked specifically for copies, hard copies, of the drawings, which I haven't had, and also all of the volumes so that I'd be able to understand it. So I wouldn't. So I'm in a position tonight at this meeting where I'm less well informed than I would like to be, and your consultation process is very poor indeed. That's my first point, and I've just got a very short second point to make. My understanding is that you report to the Secretary of State for Transport ultimately the results of this consultation, and I wanted you to take back to him a clear message from the people of Gravesend that the proposals on Route C are fundamentally unacceptable. They're unacceptable in the way that they would fragment the community, destroy in perpetuity the quality of the environment here. And thirdly, and given your own self-made objectives of resolving the problem at Dartford, be straight with him. Don't try and paper over the reality that you are unable to build your way out of congestion. That's a lesson that we've learnt over the last 30 years through all of the projects which have said, keep on widening your motorways, keep on building extra capacity, and congestion will go away. We've all learnt that that doesn't work, that the problems are far more structural and far more strategic. And take back to him that the proposals, all of the proposals, and that includes A, and C, and indeed the now abandoned B, that they are based on false premises. Firstly, that you can build your way out of congestion. You can't, and the history of highway development in England demonstrates that. Secondly, that building roads necessarily leads to growth in the economy. It doesn't, and it particularly doesn't, where it degrades the environment. And thirdly, that it is acceptable to cause permanent and long-term harm, sacrificing the interests of the local community for what can only at best be a short-term solution. Your 14% and your failure to actually deal in a satisfactory way with the question that was asked over here, the 14% that it would draw from Dartford is capacity that would be immediately taken up by suppressed demand, which is already in the system. And you're talking about a proposal 10 years from now. Be honest with the Secretary of State. Tell him it won't work. Tell him it will cause long-term and irreversible damage to Gravesham. And tell him to abandon those proposals and start looking at strategic policy means of actually improving transport and shifting traffic off roads.
Thank you very much. I'll ask Martin to talk about the issues you've had with the documentation not arriving, and then Dr. Newport to talk about the roads don't lead to the growth in the economy.
Okay, so firstly, on a personal level, clearly I want to apologise for the fact that you've had to wait so long for your documents, but I'm pleased that they've come through today. You know, the fact that we've got a full room tonight and the fact that I've seen 10,000 people over the course of the public information events is evidence to me that actually we have got the message out there. We are engaging with the community. We're having conversations. Yes, of course, you know, when you rang our helpline number, that is a national helpline number for the whole of the business. You know, you can brief as best you can, but I'm sorry you got the response you did. The important thing to know is that, you know, we are reacting to those requests. Information is now getting out. Booklets are now getting out. You know, we've had to keep some booklets back to ensure we have information available at the public events, which is our primary concern. All the information is on the website. That is kind of government policy to message things digitally. We will obviously send material out when people request it.
Dr. Newport, do roads lead to a growth in the economy?
I was very struck, actually, by an underlying comment that Mr. Potts made just earlier. He said that commercial factors govern decisions on transport, and that's why we can't direct growth into more sustainable forms of transport. Well, I would suggest that for as long as that statement remains true, and of course, at the moment, commercial factors are the primary decision that drives the choices that people make to move themselves or to move their stuff. For as long as that remains true, there's nothing much we can do about it, and I think that's where the Secretary of State needs to be able to intervene. We are inevitably drawn to a process that just requires us to put a sticking plaster over the same problem of too much reliance on an unsustainable mode of transport. And I think I'm trying to articulate this inside my own head at the moment, but that's where we need to be intervening, because otherwise we are only ever going to have more of the same. And it won't be me, but it would be terrible to think that in 20 years' time my successor will be in a school hall somewhere in Sittingbourne or Sheerness having the same arguments and the same conversations. Now is the time to do something a bit better than what we've been doing.
Hi, my name's Lenny Rolls. I am a local councillor, but I want to keep this very brief because I know there's other people who need to ask questions. I'm a little bit incensed. There's two points. Firstly, Kent County Council had a chance to offer up an opinion on three options, option A, B and C. In this consultation document that you've put to the public, it only really gives people a chance to put down their questions on their responses on option C, okay? Which comes back to another point. Several times there's been some posturing today in the responses that you've given, Mr. Potts. where you've used the government as a shield to avoid some questions, saying clearly you're from Highways England. If it's the government's will and the minister has stood up and said option A is still on the table, I would like a very straight answer as to why option A is not a part of the consultation that you've put forward, particularly when you've given others the opportunity to respond to options A and C, okay? Because I believe your consultation document is fundamentally flawed for that reason, because you should give the residents, if you've come to the public stage now, you should give the people here the same opportunity as you've given others to respond to questions about option A. Okay? My second point is, I'd like to come back to the point that Minister was saying earlier. I don't think that you have been putting forward things in a very fair way. You seem to be very defensive of the reasons why option A just will not work. And it seems that you've entered this process.
Just hold up.
You've entered this process with a very blinkered approach to option A, as though it's just off the table completely. And one part of that, why I think your consultation document is a selling document as well, is that my understanding is that the figures for option A include upgrades to certain junctions along the A2, whereas figures for option C don't include those upgrading costs. You're shaking your head there, but the costs have changed an awful lot since you first come out till now. I'd like you to categorically deny, and if you are denying it, I'd like to know exactly how you've reached those costs, of the fact that upgrades to the junctions on the A2 with the M25 are not included. And additionally,
quite a few questions there. Okay. We do need to get let but, other people but I have
would,
a chance
I would
to speak.
Like so. You, I would like you to be able to answer that question, because it is a very sales document that you've put forward. It's not a consultation document, it's just a sales
okay,
document.
I'll invite Martin to respond.
Okay, thank you. I'm glad that question came up, because clearly it does need addressing. The Minister rightly did make a statement the other day to try and clarify. So let me try and clarify. There is actually two parties here. There's the government position and Highways England position. So let me just be very clear. In 2014, when the Minister briefed Highways Agency, now Highways England, we were briefed to study options A and C. I've explained earlier in my presentation, we did that. We looked at four routes, route 1, route 2, route 3, and route 4, route 1 being option A. We were also briefed by the minister back in 2014 to bring our proposal, that's not government's proposal, but rather it's Highways England's proposal to consultation. So in our booklet, we talk about why we feel option A doesn't meet the project objectives, and that's why we were quite transparent and open in declaring that Route 3, which we felt was on balance, the right solution. Now, that doesn't mean to say, as consultees, you can't comment. Of course you can comment about A. You can comment about X if you want, a route that we've never even thought of. There's places in that consultation questionnaire that, yes, we're asking specific comments around those options that we as Highways England think are viable and meet the project objectives, but there are also open questions there that ask for any other comment, and that's everybody's opportunity to make those comments. The second point I'd like to make is that we've specifically employed an independent company to assess all those consultation responses. That's a deliberate act on our part to ensure a degree of transparency, ensure a degree of independence when such matters are reported into government. Naturally, as highway operator, we will also be reporting into government, as you'd expect. Ultimately, the decision about the route is a government one that will be taken later this year.
I'm conscious we've got about half an hour. There's a lot of people who want to ask questions. Can we ask Councillor Bryan? Just very briefly. Yeah. Very briefly. Can I ask people from now on just to ask one question, please, to allow everybody else to have a chance to have their say?
Okay, so picking up on the cost factors, the earlier study work in 2009 that led to the 2013 consultation, costs within that, as far as option A are concerned, were solely for a new bridge or tunnel at the river. When we took the wrapper off that, we soon came to the view that actually providing extra tunnel capacity or bridge capacity at the river isn't really the answer. That, of course, would have extra capacity, but if the road leading up to the crossing doesn't have the capacity to take that flow, or the junction, such at junction 30, can't cater for the movements, increased movements resulting for that increased flow, of course, the solution itself is not credible. So that's why the costs have gone up. We've had to consider all those other factors, but let's be very clear, it does not include numbers for improvements at the Beam Junction and Ebbsfleet Junction that are in our current programme.
Councillor Sweetland, then the gentleman down here, and then Councillor Hills.
Thank you very much indeed. I'm Brian Sweetland, I'm the County Councillor for Gravesham Rural. I feel as if I've been pointed out already. Thank you. I also think I'm an ordinary person as well. And certainly over the last few weeks, I've had more time on my hands to be an ordinary person. I'd like to go back to the question that Lenny Rolls asked, because I don't think you've got a proper answer. At the start of it, you said that the Secretary of State, and indeed before him the Roads Minister, had said option A is still on the table, and then you followed on to say, and you can still respond about option A, but the fact of the matter is, Mr. Potts, you can't, because it's not on the consultation. And there's the only mention of it on there is, do you use the Dartford Crossing? That's the only option. That's the only mention of it on there. And, you know, I just think there must be an enormous disconnect, because I assume you're working for the Department for Transport, ultimately, and I can't really work out, you know, when you've got the Secretary of State, and I was one of the delegation that went to see him last week, he seemed quite surprised by it all, and coming out with a statement that, oh, well, of course, we will still consider it. How can you consider it when you haven't consulted on it? And so it just makes a mockery of this consultation, it really does. So my question to you, Mr. Potts, was the Secretary of State or any of the roads ministers, anyone at all in the Department for Transport, made fully appraised of the fact that you weren't going to include option A in the consultation?
Well, naturally, you'll understand that, of course, we did brief the department ahead of consultation. One of the things that we clearly need to do is get authority to take the project to consultation. But I bring you back to those opening remarks I made around the specific instruction we received, which was to share our proposals for the project with the community. There are one of the leading questions in the questionnaire asks about option C. It also asks supplementary questions around any other routes and any other concerns people might want to raise. That's the opportunity people have to comment on A. I'm hearing also comments around D. I'm hearing comments about E, previous studies. I'm hearing comments about, you know, routes we haven't even thought of. So there are opportunities in those open box questions to respond in any way you wish.
Mr. Potts, I mean, you just haven't answered the question. And the question was, and I wrote it down to make sure I don't get it wrong, was the Secretary of State or the Roads Minister or anybody in the Department for Transport fully appraised of the fact that you were going to only consult on option C? It requires a yes or a no answer.
Yes. In fact.
Well, can I ask who?
We need to be fair, Councillor. Let other people take part as well, please. Well, we're attempting to allow him the chance to answer the question now.
The proposals and the outline for this consultation was taken through the governance procedures in the Department for Transport.
Okay. Gentleman down here, please.
Name's Samir.
Just talk
Samir Jassel, Borough Councillor for Sean Cobham and Ludsdown. Mr. Potts, I think your studies are completely flawed, because you talk about the roads around Gravesham, being able to deal with more congestion. Well, the fact is, if after 6 a.m. on any given morning from Monday to Friday, if you're going London bound, you know, and we start from Strood coming up to Cobham, I mean, it's already almost standstill. So how on earth are we going to allow more congestion on those roads? And we go the other way, and I use it every morning to drop my son off in Rochester, and we use Watling Street going down into Stroudways. Again, that's another road which is completely congested and which will be part of the spider run of roads which will continue to get congested if we go forward with this plan. But with my other hat on, I'm also the Cabinet Member for Business Development, but every business I've spoken to over the past 6 or 7 months has categorically said the same thing. This will be an absolute disaster for businesses in Gravesham and businesses that use Gravesham as a hub and supply their goods out of Gravesham. So my question is, if it doesn't work for the residents, we'll be using the roads, it doesn't work for the businesses that work in and out of Gravesham, why on earth is this still on the paperwork?
So thank you. If I heard correctly, I think part of that question was around the challenge that on the A2 at peak time that obviously carries significant volumes of traffic. One thing that we have to do in looking at any of these options is not only look at the particular route we might be proposing or on the traffic that might carry, but also we need to look at the connecting road networks. And the advantage of a C solution has over an A solution is that a C solution brings relief to the A2. It brings relief to the A13. because well, that's what our traffic modelling shows. Traffic that currently needs to go into Essex from the Kent ports or into the Midlands from the Kent ports would naturally use a C route as opposed to going up to Dartford. Now, the consequence of that is, of course, the flows London bound in a morning on the A2 would reduce. And that's what our traffic flow, that's what our traffic modelling is showing. Any proposal that we look at, we need to understand the full implications of that on all the road networks. And that's a significant finding that C offers benefit over A.
Councillor Hills and the lady behind. Can you use the microphone here, please? Or thank you.
Thank you. My name is Councillor Hills, Leslie Hills, and I'm a Gravesham Borough Council member for Chalk Ward. I was hoping tonight to speak for a few minutes, but that wasn't to be. But if anybody's interested in what I would have said, we have another meeting tomorrow night at 7 o'clock at St Mary's Church in Chalk. So I thought I'd use the opportunity to announce that. There's been a lot spoken about pollution this evening. My concern is for environmental vandalism. I represent the people of Chalk, amongst others, but really this matter concerns almost everybody in the borough. At Chalk, we have it's just the area where the tunnel will be built, the entrance to the tunnel from the Kent side. It's an area of green belt. It's an area of high scientific interest. It's a major bird sanctuary, and the whole area is part of the strategic gap between Gravesend and Medway. The proposals, although you say you're only talking about highways, the proposals for option C include means to stimulate regeneration in the area, to produce economic growth and further development. Now, my concern is that as this is protecting land, where are you going to create all this growth and development in the area? We saw what happened at Dartford. Even the approach roads to the tunnels have adjacent new housing alongside them. We've seen hotels, supermarkets, business parks. I don't want Chalk and Higham Marshes to become another business park such as they have at Dartford. So where is all this local development going to come, as you mention in your document?
I'll let Martin answer first on that, and then Hilary Newport on the environmental impact.
Okay, so there's a couple of points there. So the first, I think, was a challenge around where we're proposing the route and what effect it have on the environment, and the importance clearly of the Ramsar site and the sites of special scientific interest. That's respecting that environmental footprint. You know, that's one of the primary reasons why we're proposing a bored tunnel under that sensitive site, so we kind of don't disturb it. So that's the first point I want to make. As far as economic development, these are matters for the local authority in terms of their planning plans and aspirations into how they might redesignate land and so on and so forth. The point we make in our consultation documents around our proposal supporting economic development, as I said earlier on, our traffic modelling work does factor in all those growth plans that local authorities have in their development plans. In that way, our proposals support economic growth, but it's not for Highways England clearly to determine where that business and housing development might come.
Dr. Newport, on the environmental impact.
Again, I'm struck that so much of what's being tried to achieve... Well, sorry, let me start again and shoot for a whole sentence. I'm struck that what we're trying to achieve through this Highways England consultation is just acknowledging and accepting that what we must do is foster and encourage the growth of freight. I think it's going to be very, very hard to factor in proper protection of very important designations. When you look at the layer upon layer of important scientific designations and protections that should be taken for granted here, it's very hard to see how that can really be respected in the event of this degree of planning. Now, my job covers the whole of Kent. This is a local issue, of course, but it has hugely wider implications. But we are wrestling at the moment with a planning system where local authorities are obliged to set high local authorities are obliged to set high targets for housing. They're obliged to move mountains in order to meet those high targets. District after district across Kent and my colleagues in other branches of CPRE are telling me it's happening in just the same way. They're having to ride roughshod over designations like Grade 1 agricultural land. Well, surely we need to be protecting this. All the time that the growth in traffic is driven by profit, we are going to find it incredibly hard to turn this juggernaut around. All the time that we've got a government that's driven to deliver houses at almost any cost, that's another juggernaut that we're struggling to turn around. We seriously need some intervention that delivers genuine, sustainable solutions. Otherwise, I think we are going to find ourselves in a highly degraded environment, and I wish I could be more optimistic, but we see this happen over and over again.
Thank you. Lady down here, gentleman there, and the gentleman there.
I'll have to grow. Just a couple of points. I think there's only one person here who's got a vision for the future, and that's Dr. Newport. We're an island. We've got all these ports. You look at it, Felixstowe, Harwich, take them straight up there. That is the vision, and I'm really for that. We have to look, we're told, long term. We don't want a quick fix it. We don't want a 5-year plan and then have another 10-year plan and it go on and on. So, Dr. Newport, I really admire you. Thank you. To add to that, if this is a sales pitch, which I think it is, this brochure on page 13 or 12, I can't read it, but it's point 2.88. A tunnel with two lanes in each direction with additional space to provide future capacity is proposed. Now that follows on to the point that was just mentioned. There will be houses, there will be a business park, there will be lots of infrastructure put there, exactly the same as Dartford. That is Martin Potts's vision of the future. I like Dr. Hilary Newport's vision.
So, yes, so I think there's a question there, although most of it was a statement, I believe, but I think the question about the tunnel, yes, we are talking about an oversized tunnel. One of the primary reasons we would propose such a tunnel in that form is to consider the safety implications. One of the way you can operate those tunnels safely is to have an emergency lane. But, you know, yeah, recognising for what it is, it's much better to have a larger tunnel than something that is overly small, which is actually where we were with the Dartford proposals.
Gentleman here in the fourth row. Can you could you come round to the front, sir? Apologise for the disruptions. If I could ask people if you could identify yourselves, please, just for the purposes of the webcast. Thank you. Once you get to the microphone, yes. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Makhan Singh, one of the local councillors representing Pelham Ward. And I believe this construction will affect whole of Gravesham. That is my sincere opinion. And I'm glad to say that we've had fair discussion at the local authority level, and we're all very united to point out to the government that this particular option will be devastating. For when I came to this country, and when I lived in Yorkshire, I was told that Kent was known as the Garden of England. It appears to me that's becoming a garden of jungle, garden of concrete. Unfortunately, I know we've got to have an infrastructure. I understand we've got the Eurorail, which is good. And may I say, Dr. Newport is very imaginatively, innovatively said we need to really direct some of our heavy traffic onto the freight rail, the freight traffic onto rail. And you said very rightly, Mr. Potts, yes, we've got the capacity. And I can't see why. And I'm saying successive governments haven't really paid heed to this rail track. You know, we need to put the traffic on the rail. And I agree with my previous speaker, with us said about the traffic which already exists. You know, when we travel to schools, when we travel, and you've admittedly said that you haven't taken the traffic into account regarding the Paramount Park. And may I say to you, it will have traffic during the peak time too, because the people who work there, the staff, they will be travelling the same time as the school's traffic. So there is that factor.
And can I just
make a quote?
I don't mean to be rude. There are a lot of people who want to speak, so if
so
I can ask you to be brief.
Please go back to the government and do what Councillor Sweetland said early on. Are they really discussing, giving us the chance to make sure that option A goes on the table and give it a serious consideration, because it's going to be less costly. So economically, it's going to be much cheaper. So please, can you go back, and can you promise us that you will be going back and take the views of the people here in Gravesham and not ignore us? So this is all I want to say. Thank you.
So just to avoid any doubt, if anybody in the audience wants to comment on option A, you must do so. You know, the minister has been very clear in his announcements about option A. Option A is still there. We did study it in detail, in comparable detail with options 2, 3, and 4. And as I say, we concluded that against the transport objectives of the project, it performs less well.
Gentleman here.
Thank you, Chairman. One of the things I've found as a problem, I'll say who I am first. I'm Colin Callagher, I'm the Kent member for Gravesham East. And I'll say that I wasn't intending to speak tonight because I've had opportunities. Just that there's been a number of comments that have concerned me. We've heard about congestion at the current crossing at Dartford. We've heard of the problems with the A282. We've heard of flow breakdown, and we've heard about the standing traffic and the environmental impact that has. It's all accepted, and I've got great sympathy for the people at Dartford. But however, we're then told that this new crossing will only take 14% of that traffic away from the Dartford crossing. So I believe that you failed to answer the fundamental question that is really sitting there and staring us in the face. Given that northbound traffic has to be stopped at Dartford at least 15 times a day in order to enable other traffic to go through that tunnel. Can you tell me how you consider building this additional crossing east of Gravesend actually deals with the congestion at Dartford, deals with the impact of the A282, because you've not come up with any suggestion to actually bypass that completely and build a completely new crossing at that location with a bored tunnel. How it deals with the flow breakdown that you currently suffer and will continue to suffer at Dartford, and how it deals with their problem of the standing traffic and their air pollution problem. When you ask those questions, I think you get back to the fundamentals and you conclude that this one shouldn't be going ahead. So I'd like
to... Okay, quite a few questions there, Colin, but I think the first one is a direct comparator. So we did look in detail at option A. We found that investing there, yes, it would be cheaper than option C, but only marginally so. Our figures were about $3.5 billion for that proposal. It would induce a 5-minute improvement in peak time, assuming the road network is kind of working properly. We'd have the same transport benefit with a C solution that brought about by the reduction of traffic that the 14% draws away from Dartford. So they are directly comparable in that respect. I think, you know, we're talking all evening here, we've been talking about kind of final solution. We also need to recognise what construction means, and we've paid little attention to that. Constructing at A would be phenomenally challenging. It would disrupt traffic like you haven't seen before. If you thought that building the free flow infrastructure was troublesome, building a new crossing there and all the associated changes to the road network leading to it would be of an order of magnitude again. There'd be 6 years of construction activity. Why am I saying that? I'm saying it because Highways England know this sort of thing. This is our business. We've spent many years. I was personally involved on the M25 widening work in the last 6-7 years. You know, it is phenomenally challenging to build additional infrastructure alongside live traffic. You know, that would be a significant challenge to us to make that work. That's one of the, you know, the reasons we're also thinking it's not viable. Economically, it performs less well. So, yes, in terms of the ultimate position, it performs similarly to C.
Okay, Martin. Lady down here, gentleman up there, and then Councillor Cubitt.
The week before the consultation started, we had a letter put through the door. My name is Angela, I live Marling Cross, Watling Street, to say that if it went through this C, my house would be compulsory purchased. So can you tell me, like, if it does go through, how long before you make me homeless? And not just me, but there's lots of, there's only 8 houses where I live, plus I know people that are here that also are going to lose like part of their gardens and part of their houses. And it's not being funny, it's sleepless nights, it's caused rows, aggravation and the upset of it. But so what do we do? Where do we stand? Do we, you know, where do we go to live? You know, where do we find a house? You know, we, it's terrible. I mean, I can't remember when, well, since it all started this, when I've gone to bed and slept, to be honest with you. I've lost weight. And I've got a granny flat in my daughter's garden. We haven't spoke for 3 weeks because of what's going on. And I'm not the only person. There's a lady over there, lives in Shawn. She's not long been there, paid a lot of money. It's caused upset and rows in her house. And I don't think it's right.
Okay, thank you. We need to get other people in, but I'll ask Martin to answer that question. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that question. let me start by saying there's never a good time, of course, to receive such a letter. And I fully acknowledge the worry and concern that naturally that would bring. That's not to say it was inappropriate to write the letter, because you know the first time you receive you know such a letter, of course it's concerning and alarming. The important thing that we need to recognise is that you know the government is asking Highways England to bring proposals to consultation. Of course, we want to reach out to all the community. We felt especially concerned that we should make that extra effort to reach out to those householders that might be personally affected. It's hugely important that everybody responds to this consultation. This will help inform the government and inform the government about a decision going forward. Now, I can't sit here and tell you when the government will make such a decision. What we are advising is that we expect the government to make a decision this year. Now, what would that decision be? That decision would be, if the government proceed to go ahead with the project, that would be a decision over the preferred route. So clearly, once the route is selected, householders kind of know which route is selected. Now, that's not to say that's the end of it. There's an awful lot more that needs to happen. There's an awful lot more talking to do before government ultimately might make a decision to invest and build and compulsory purchase properties. There'd be a second round of public consultation probably in 2018 around the specifics of any design that we might table. Following that, there would be planning considerations through a development consent order, where again public and consultees can make statements to the examiner. So there's two further opportunities to make opinion known, and then ultimately, you know, once the government, if the government chooses to proceed with the works, once that final decision is made, that's the time that sort of compulsory purchase takes effect. And that in reality is 4 or 5 years away. But the first milestone is that government decision over preferred route.
Martin, thank you. I'm keen to get as many people as possible in the limited time we have available. Gentleman up there first, and then Councillor Cubitt.
Thank you. My name's Andrew Pickwell. I'm a resident of Chalk. This question is a local question. What concerns me about the very thick line drawn on the simple map that I saw was the fact that you are even considering putting a local junction on the Rochester Road linking onto it. If, as the Highways Agency, you're serious about moving a lot of traffic off of the A2 and getting it across the river, I would suggest that it's just a straight trunk road with no local roads going off at all, because if there's any sort of problem on it, of course everybody's going to try and get off of it and come through Gravesend, and that happens already even with the A2 without any additional roads. If you're serious about moving serious amounts of traffic, it needs to be just a simple road straight through with no junctions off of it, much as the M40 is and the Birmingham bypass.
Okay, thank you very much for that question. And of course, you're quite right that a local junction isn't absolutely necessary of this scheme. The scheme is primarily about improving capacity on the strategic highway network, and that's about ultimately connecting the M2/A2 with the M25. That's why we've got a specific question in the consultation around junctions. You know, we need to know local community opinion. It, you know, there might be a desire to have connectivity, there might be a desire for no connectivity. There's kind of a saying, you know, we a bit of banter in the office about the network. Our network, the strategic network, would run exceedingly well if there are no junctions to it. Now, that might sound a bit flip, but the reality is, you know, traffic comes from local networks onto the major network, goes about its business and delivers something ultimately to your door if you've ordered something off Amazon. That's kind of what goes on. So it is about the benefits of junctions and connectivity weighed up against the disbenefits of traffic coming off those junctions should there be aspects of stress. And that's what's felt on the A282. One of the reasons why Dartford and Thurrock lock up when something goes wrong on the major network is people are trying to jump the queue. You know, I'm very familiar with, and residents in Thurrock have shared this with me, you know, if queues back up towards Junction 29, they come off at Junction 29, nip along the A127, down the B186, I think it is, through residential areas, trying to get through to Junction 31. And similar things happen in Dartford as stuff tries to divert off the A2, maybe through Gravesham and Gravesend, rather, to get to Junction 1A. So that's about drivers, getting off the network to try and jump the queue to get back on the network at what is a solitary crossing. That's, you know, that's one of the dynamics that goes on and we need to kind of think about.
Councillor John Cubitt, leader of Gravesham Borough Council, and the gentleman with his hand up in the fourth row at the back.
Thank you. There's so much to this that I could speak for an hour and you want about 1 minute. First of all, the strategic answer is the one that Dr. Henry Newport's put forward. Unfortunately, I think it's going to be longer than we have in order to deal with what we have to deal with. But coming back to the local plan and why I particularly put my hand up to this, is this assessment has got nothing to do with our local plan. Our local plan shows no building, no business parks, no houses, whatever in the whole of the area. The environmental area that this is looking to decimate. So don't say we've taken on board the local authority, maybe some other authorities, but if you've taken our local plan into account, there's no extra traffic due to any housing or build right across that. But can I come to the question? There's two elements. The big problem, as you said, if things can go on without going through junctions, join the M25 to the M25. Don't go through all the mishmash of the local traffic at Dartford. They've built a 6-mile tunnel under Paris. It shouldn't be beyond the width of our highways, England, to perhaps go underneath the whole damn lot. But my question, and this is the fundamental question for this proposal, is this proposal is absolutely not viable. The traffic to and fro from Doverport uses the M20. How does the M20 traffic get to your tunnel? What are the roads they're going to use? What are the gradients? And how happy will people be to have them going through the 249, the 229, the 228, the 227 without causing enormous gridlock? How do you propose traffic gets to and from the end of your tunnel towards the M20 and Operation Stack?
Okay, thank you. So, as I indicated earlier, our traffic modelling work does recognise what's going on local road networks, and it is predicting that 40% of traffic would be diverted from Dartford to the new tunnel. Yes, some of it will go on various routes, to get to that new crossing, whether it be on the M2 or the M20.
Right, gentleman there, then gentleman down there. Can I just repeat? People cannot, listening to the webcast, cannot hear you, so I appreciate you want to make points. I'd like to give as many people as possible the chance to make their points tonight. Very, very. 1 second, please. Sir, please. I'm attempting to ask Martin to answer the question, but if you and I are shouting at each other, it's not very productive. Martin.
Yes, so our in summary terms, our traffic analysis does indicate that clearly with the C solution, there are some increased movements on the M2, there's some increased movements on the M20, there's some increased movements on the 229, there's decreased movements on the A2, west of its connection with the new crossing. should it be at sea, and there's similar reductions on the M20 itself. So, you know, we are duty-bound in any of our proposals to look at the effect on all the adjacent networks.
Right, we have just 10 more minutes left for questions. Gentleman there, then gentleman at the back.
Hello, my name's Dakota Dibben. I'm a resident of Shoreham. My question is, in 2013, the Department of Transport, for Transport, report made it clear in the summary of that report, I quote, if new capacity is provided by option C, it is likely the existing Dartford Crossing will remain close to capacity, and although delays will be reduced, incidents could still lead to long delays as they do not do at, as they do at present. And my question to Martin Potts this evening is, why was the statement ignored by Highways England when that you chose not to include option A?
Okay, so I would suggest that it wasn't ignored, and why am I saying that? Because we studied option A comprehensively, we studied option C comprehensively. Option A is, you know, we do recognise it will always be a busy crossing. So why am I saying that? Because it's on the desire for much of the traffic. Councillor Cubitt earlier on said, why didn't we build a tunnel under Dartford to cater for the M25 traffic? That isn't the majority of traffic going across Dartford does not start south of Junction 2 and finish north of Junction 30. Only about a third of the traffic that makes that movement is that traffic. And equally, a third comes either off or on at the A2 or the A13. This is the sole crossing of the Thames estuary outside London. It caters for local traffic movements just as well as much as strategic traffic movements.
Gentlemen here. Gentleman at the back has been very patient with his hand up, and the gentleman over there. No, sorry, this gentleman here.
No problem. Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. Mr. Potts, I've got a problem here, and that is to understand at what point in time would you really recognize the value of your public consultation, and how would that in any way impact on your final proposal of Route C?
Okay, so of course I recognise the value of public consultation. The fact that we've got a public meeting this evening to discuss proposals, and I very much welcomed the invitation along this evening. I and the team have had an opportunity to talk to over 10,000 people through public engagement events. You know, that's hugely important to us. This is an outstanding response to the consultation. I haven't seen, in terms of volume, this sort of response on previous work. So I would put it to you that we are effectively reaching out. The fact that you're responding very confidently and in an assured manner about our proposals is the very thing that we want. We want you to think about our proposals seriously. We want that comment to come into the business. That is hugely important to government in ultimately making a decision. As I said earlier, all your comments will be reported on by an independent company. We've employed Ipsos Mori to do that work on our behalf. That is important to government in ultimately making a decision.
Martin, let's squeeze some more in. Gentlemen,
can I just add one thing to that, just to make the process clear? The timetable, which I think you were asking about, is that Highways England will deliver its recommendation or its findings from this consultation to the Department for Transport and Secretary of State in June. Yeah. We have a challenge at the moment because, as Martin says, the response to consultation has been much larger than we thought, so it may take us a little longer to process that information. And as Martin said earlier, we can't tell you, because we're not in control of the Secretary of State's timetable, how long he will take to decide or what the next steps are after that. The obligation on Highways England is to develop the proposals, to analyse them and to consult with the public, to gather views, to take those views into account and to formulate some recommendations on the back of those views, and they'll go to the Secretary of State, ultimately the decision maker, And as Martin's pointed out, the decision maker is saying, look, option A, option C, it's all out there. Yeah. Our consultation is about the proposals the Highways England has developed. Okay, so I hope that
Mike,
helps.
Thanks very much. Let's try and squeeze a few more people in. Gentlemen at the top, can I ask you to keep your points or your questions brief, please?
Yes. My name's Peter Morton. I'm a resident of Shaw. What I want to know is why can Eddie Stobart profit actually take his containers up to the Midlands by rail and then distribute them from there, and you can't organise that from down here? You know, and also we have lorries coming through from France over to here and going over to Ireland. Why can't they go across from Le Havre to Cork instead of coming through Kent? And the other thing I want to know is why are you allowing all this traffic to come through our lovely countryside? It is crazy. And also, why are you being the consultants, getting other people to do your dirty work for you by them having this consultancy? I think you are really, really annoying to people in this area.
Okay, thank you very much indeed, Martin.
Okay, thank you. That's not the first time that the point's been made about rail freight. You know, I can't answer in detail about that. It would be inappropriate of me to try and pretend that I could. These are strategic matters essentially for the government of the day. You know, let's bring us back to what I'm here for this evening. Highways England has been instructed by the department and the Secretary of State to look at a road-based solution to the problems at Dartford. We are sharing our thinking with you. We're very keen to get feedback. By all means, comment about rail freight and so on if you wish. Ultimately, though, the decision will be made by government. There's no absolute certainty on what the government decide. You know, what we're duty-bound to do, you and I together, working collaboratively, is go back with opinion. We all, obviously, as Highways England, have our professional and technical opinion. You as consultees, clearly, your opinions are equally important, and please make them known in that consultation.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have to be out of this hall by 9:30. So I want Hilary Newport and Martin Potts to sum up for a couple of minutes. I'll try and squeeze in a few more questions. Please do keep them brief, though. Gentleman at the back.
My name's James. I'm a resident.
Hold your microphone up, please, sir.
Sorry, I'm a resident of Riverview Park. 2 points. One is, I totally disagree with what you're saying about the cost at Dartford. A broad tunnel would probably cost something in the region of £1 billion. It could be bored. The actual boring would actually take approximately 6 months, and another 6 months to link the roads up. You're talking about 1 year. If you started now, that could probably all be finished in 18 months' time. In the meantime, the bridge is now approximately 24 years old, is had to be closed on numerous occasions in the last 4 years, and it will probably be out of service in another 20 years' time. If you look at the other major bridges, suspension bridges, around the United Kingdom, because none of them had a life of more than 60 years. And the second point is, regarding transferring the traffic to the sea, you're saying 14%, which I think is rather over the top. Maybe even 10%. But 10%, if you charge every vehicle £10 a time, you wouldn't even pay the interest on £5 billion loan.
Right, thank you very much. So, lady down here in the purple.
I'm Susan Lindley. I'm actually a parish councillor in Shawn, and I'm also a committee member of the Dickens Country Protection Society. But I'm asking this as a personal question. One of the important elements of any consultation is the quality. I'm picking up on a couple of points that were made earlier. Mr. Brown said, for example, that wasn't possible to put all the information in. But my question really is, how can you make an informed decision without the information? The ethos of this consultation seems to be you're asking people to make a decision, and you're going to actually find out the information later. Maybe I don't quite understand that really. I'm a scientist, I'm sorry, I don't can't cope with it.
Just very briefly now, because I can squeeze somebody else
sorry,
in, please.
And the one of the reasons you've had such a high response rate is because, I don't know if it's all, but certainly a good proportion of the people who are registered for the DART charge have been emailed with a link to the consultation asking them to participate. And the bulk of these people will be people who know absolutely nothing about the area or the issues concerned. They won't have bothered at all to look at even the summary document. So they're not really making informed decisions. The other thing you said was about there is space for open answers, as it were, but the construction of the questionnaire is that all the questions are actually leading questions. I'm sure if you feel so minded, you can put things in the box which aren't being asked. But again, the bulk of people won't realise they have that option or be able to do so. And lastly, I mean, it has been referred to as a sales brochure. I'd say that the consultation really is not a consultation. It's actually just an opinion poll. And I think it really, I mean, given that we know, sorry to be rude to Maury, but we do know their track record on opinion polls from the election. I think really there should be as much credence to the results of this consultation in terms of the bulk responses as there have been to several others.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to take that as a point. Lady over there with a hand up. Thank you.
I've got quite a simple question, actually, again to do with maths. You said you'll take 14% of the existing traffic through going through the Dartford Tunnel, which by my estimate is about 22,000, but you're estimating that the daily traffic across the new crossing will be 78,000. So where are the other 56,000 vehicles per day coming from?
Thank you.
Okay, so I spoke earlier about Dartford having been essentially in a state of stress for some 15 years. You know, we do recognise that there is suppressed demand at that crossing. You know, the only in an open society where you're allowing traffic free access to the network, the only way you can sort of free up what is a congested situation at Dartford is to by way of making exit capacity. That capacity, you know, to a degree will be used. People will make journeys that they haven't made before. Now, this, you know, that also addresses some of the, you know, sort of economic benefit that will come out of this proposal. Yes, you know, business will grow, things will happen, you know, people might take a job north of the river that otherwise they wouldn't have.
Okay, just very briefly, gentlemen down here, please, and then I'll invite both to sum up.
Hi, my name's Mike Cavender, I'm from Higham. Just a few, not really a question, just statements, basically. We're basically trying to get rid of lorries off the roads. We don't want congestion, we don't want road repairs, we don't want pollution. There is only one option, and that is option C, S-E-A.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very sorry to cut this short, but we do, as I say, have to be out of the hall. So I'm going to invite both people on the panel to sum up, starting, please, with Dr. Newport.
I am so going to steal and plagiarise that last comment. Thank you. I think it's become abundantly apparent, even more so to me this evening, that the problems that Kent's facing with congestion at Dartford and with Operation Stack are just symptoms of the same underlying problem. And we've got the Department of Transport inviting us to choose what colour of sticking plaster we put on them. I've got incredible respect for the grief and the pain that people are going through because of the blight and the uncertainty of this, but I have been incredibly impressed by the strength of people's arguments. One thing I would like to do, just on a practical and hopefully helpful level, is many of you have been very, very kind in your support for the arguments and the policy positions that we're putting forward. So as early as I'm able to tomorrow, I will put a summary of what I've said today on our website. So if you want to expand on or explore any of the arguments that we've made for yourselves in your own responses, please do so. I would invite you, while you're on our website, and just Google CPRE Kent, take a look at the donate button. We are a charity which is entirely supported by its members and supporters. We can't do any of this without you. Before you leave, you will be accosted by my colleague Paul, who has got some leaflets about a bit more information about CPRA. But if you like what we do, please help us carry on doing it for as many communities as we possibly can. And just thank you for your attention today. I've learned a lot. It's been incredibly useful for me, and we hope we can support you through these challenging times.
Martin.
Okay, thank you, Ian. So firstly, I very much welcome the opportunity to have answered your questions this evening. I hope they went some way to address your concerns. Of course, I understand and absolutely acknowledge the strength of feeling in the room within this community and clearly other communities I've addressed, such as at Tilbury the other evening last week. We've got a lot to take away from this consultation. It's going to be our job within Highways England to consider all your comments and responses and, you know, fulfil our duty to government to report back into government. You know, projects like this don't come around very often. We have a problem to solve. You know, that, if nothing else, you know, I'd like us to acknowledge there is a problem that needs to be solved. We're not helping communities that live on top of the A282 local to Dartford just to allow the situations to continue there with standing traffic for many times of the year. What's important to recognise, of course, is that we're still at the early stages of consultation. As I explained earlier, there will be another round of consultation should the government want to proceed with this project when we consult over the absolute of the design. And then there'd be further interrogation during the planning process. You know, we need to get used to this engagement, and I would, you know, I'd very much value the opportunity to meet you again when, you know, at our public information events or clearly further down the line at further consultation if the government should choose to proceed. What it's ultimately about is actually getting the best of this project. We've got a brief to deliver a project that takes that fair and right balance against all the proposals, against all people's wishes. You know, there's not an absolute nugget that says this is right by everybody. It's got to be a balanced thing. It's got to be something that is we make the best of it, recognizing there are challenges ahead. And it's about getting that feedback from you to help us take those conversations forward. You know, it is fundamental to this process that you do take the trouble to engage and make constructive comment. Thank you.
Thank you to both Dr. Hilary Newport and to Martin Potts. Thank you very much indeed for attending. Anybody who didn't get a chance to speak, I do apologise, but we were on a time limit. A reminder, this was not part of the official Highways England consultation. The way to feedback, I'm told, is via the website, or I'm told you will be sent paper copies of forms to fill in if you request them. Thank you for your attendance tonight. Can I just remind people going home, it is a residential area, so please show consideration when leaving. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.